Reindeer are a cheap, dependable food source for rural Alaskans, and the reindeer business is growing after nearly dying out a few decades ago. In 1978, Alaska Review looked at the resurgence of reindeer herding and the effect of antler sales and modern husbandry on the industry. Recent developments follow our original report.
It's 1 a.m. in Deering, Alaska. These people are waiting for the reindeer to arrive. Reindeer roundups have been a part of Alaskan life since the deer were brought over from Siberia at the turn of the century. But the reason for today's roundup has changed. These animals aren't being brought in for slaughter, but they're being herded in to have their antlers removed. Once the antlers are taken, the animals are released, and the horns are carefully weighed, frozen, and flown to San Francisco, where they are processed and shipped to the Orient. There they are consumed as an ancient Oriental medicine. Mr. Chung, an herbal merchant from Chinatown in San Francisco, explains their value.
The antlers in Chinese medicine is used for for people in general weakness to build up blood or build up strength or build up energy. In the Chinese medicine book, they don't advocate that this particular item is just for the aphrodisiac purpose. However, if anyone take deer horn or ginseng to build his body up in a more strong and strange, of course, you have everything, energy, and also the sex ability. We sell it in two ways. One is the original because that you can show people that this is the real McCoy. In another word, there's no imitation. Make sure this is the real one. Like this one is the short one. This is the spotted deer. And the long one, this is the Siberian or the Outer Mongolia one. And then now, here you get this. Spotted deer, sliced into pieces and packaged like that.
Do you believe that this is an effective medicine?
Oh yes, this is effective medicine. Otherwise, people don't want to pay that kind of high price for something that they don't have any effect at all.
What is the price?
The price for this one, small packages, after finish and slice, retailing, at $20 to $30 a package. It is a little over 1.5 ounce to 2 ounce.
Reindeer were imported from Siberia to the Seward Peninsula in 1892 as a supplement to the Eskimo subsistence diet. This early corral near Barrow was made of huge chunks of ice. Laplanders from Northern Europe, a people who have tended reindeer for centuries, were brought over to Alaska to help the fledgling industry. With the advent of the gold rush, droves of hungry miners invaded the Seward Peninsula and established a lucrative market for reindeer meat. Natives took care of the local market, and a white family, the Lohman brothers, this is Carl Lohman here, controlled the export market. The reindeer herds flourished, reaching an estimated peak of 650,000 animals in the late 1920s. But by that time, the miners were gone, and the Lomans had been unable to secure a steady market outside for the meat. There was no need for that many reindeer, so they were left to join traveling bands of caribou or to be eaten by wolves. Congress passed a law in 1937 allowing only Alaskan natives to own reindeer in Alaska and tried to bolster the sagging industry. But by 1950, domesticated reindeer herds had crashed to about 25,000 animals, about the same number of animals that exist in Alaska today. Most of them are scattered in 17 small herds on the Seward Peninsula, like Alfred Carman's in Deering. The herders let the deer roam free most of the year and stay with them only during certain critical periods.
My father and my mother told me that I was born right at the herd, just little west of Cape Essenberg. During the fawning, the boys have to be out and watch them every day, because there's a lot of predators. Wolverine, black crows, ravens we call them, and wolves at times, and bears too. But ravens are real bad when the fawns are young.
Even though the antlers can be worth as much money as an entire reindeer, most of the herders still manage their herds for meat production. A few of the deer, like this one, are butchered during the spring roundup, but the fall roundup is when most of the butchering is done.
Last winter we killed a little over 300, and my son Harry get all his help from the village. The whole village would be willing to go out and help them butcher, then in turn they'll earn meat by doing that, and the whole village will have meat, and we can't go without.
Tell me about the horn business. How does that work, and when did you get started in that?
Well, horn business, when they first start cutting horns, we didn't want to cut horns. We didn't want to hurt, I didn't want to hurt the deer or something. We didn't know if they'd be good on account of if they bleed a lot, there'll be a lot of dead deer. But I heard Wang told them, he said if any of the herders lose deer from them cutting horns, he'll pay for them. And that's how he started. And ever since that went well, everybody was interested in it then.
The antler roundup gives the herders a chance to count their animals, mark their fawns, and castrate some of the bulls, which improves the meat quality. But it also gives entire villages a chance to get together in a rodeo-like atmosphere and enjoy the first nice days of spring.
Does cutting the horns physically hurt the reindeer?
No, I'm convinced that there's very, very little pain involved with cutting. I've paid some attention to that years ago, watching very closely several hundred animals being having their antlers cut off. This amputation takes milliseconds, and I rarely see a reindeer even blinking his eyes when the actual severing takes place.
Timing the cutting is critical. There's a 2-week period when the horns are in the velvet and the prized blood is in the horns. It's the only time the antlers are good to cut. That's why a helicopter is used to bring the deer in.
How long have they been using helicopters for herding like this?
About 5 years.
I started, probably the only one that's still doing it, that's ever done it.
I tried herding with airplane. I did that for 2 or 3 years. But that's all right for a while. After a couple hours, the deer get used to the airplane and they just ignore it. So, the helicopter was just the only thing to do.
You consider it a risky proposition every year?
Yeah, it is. It's one of the hardest ones, but risk is just what you make of it. Be careful. I've been doing it for 4 or 5 years, and I haven't had any problems. But as you probably observe, it's kind of a specialized deal, and I just learned as I went along.
Jim Isabel's unique talents were lost when he was killed here in his helicopter 1 week later. Traditional antler medicine is made from a small Chinese deer with horns like an elk. Reindeer horn is a recent newcomer to this centuries-old market. Johnny Wang, a Korean, pioneered the reindeer horn industry, and in 15 years he's developed a complex international organization that moves the horns from reindeer on remote Alaskan tundra to the consumer in Asia.
People have said Johnny Wang's been ripping us off. Do you think that you've been ripping off the people?
They need the processing and marketing, and I need their products. So we combine the effort to reach our ultimate goal of to achieve a good price and good income. That's most of it. So I never feel that I did rip them off, and I never did, and I never will.
Do you use it?
Yes, I do. And I think it's helped, too.
Reindeer horns are worth up to $20 a pound in the field to the herders. This growing market has caught the eye of NANA, the Kotzebue region's successful native corporation. They've purchased 3 herds on the Seward Peninsula. John Schaefer, president of NANA.
Why is NANA involved in the reindeer business?
Well, the main reason was to come up with an alternative meat source to caribou that we had some control over. The other reason was to look at the industry to see if we could build it back up, because at one time reindeer herding on the Seward Peninsula was a very big industry. And it looks like now, with the price of antlers what they are, that it could be a very economical industry.
Dr. Jack Lewick is the major reindeer scientist in Alaska. He's devoting a lot of his time studying practical problems and working with the herders.
Well, there's a need for massive support of in many facets of the reindeer industry. We need educational programs for the herders, for apprentice herders, for their assistance. We need training in veterinary medicine. We need, especially need extension type people out working with the herds, experienced extension agents assigned to the Seward Peninsula to work with the herders. And besides that, of course, we have all these just good basic problems of an experimental nature that need to be supported.
Lewick is concerned about the fact that herd populations haven't increased for almost 20 years.
I think it is a major problem confronting the industry today. It's not a matter of where can we sell more meat, because the market is excellent. So we have to get in and see if how the ranges look. Are they being grazed excessively? Or is somehow related to antler cutting. Antler cutting started in Alaska in about 1963, and that's about the time that the numbers of reindeer on the Seward Peninsula leveled off at about 20,000 head.
Despite these and other perennial problems, like dealing with the federal bureaucracy and the threat of the reindeer running off with wild caribou, the market for the reindeer horn is healthy.
I think we have more than 1 billion population that use the deer horn. Actually, there's not enough in this world to supply. You can sell them all if you have it.
And the effects of this medicine may alleviate some of the chronic economic problems that face many of the villages in Bush, Alaska.
What's the best thing about herding to you?
I like to save the reindeer for ourselves and My son is now managing it, and it's growing.
The reindeer industry has kept growing. Over the past 5 years, two new herds have been started, and the total number of reindeer has increased by about 20%. Providing a secure source of meat to rural Alaskans is still the priority of the herders, but the antler industry also continues to provide a good cash income. After reaching a high of nearly $50 a pound in 1980, the field price of reindeer antler now fluctuates between $25 and $40 a pound. Demand for the horn varies. Political and economic shifts in Asia and competition between types and producers of horn all affect the market. Though the price has dropped, antler harvesting is still a money-making venture for the herders. Cooperation between the herders, state, and federal agency has resulted in more plentiful, healthier reindeer. Veterinary training programs, more efficient herding methods, and disease control are all factors in the population upswing. Over the last 2 years, many of the reindeer have been treated by the University of Alaska Institute of Arctic Biology for warble flies, one of the most serious reindeer health problems. The warble fly is a parasite. In the summer, the egg is laid in the deer's fur. It hatches into a larva, or warble, which burrows under the animal's skin. The larva travels through the deer during the winter, then pupates and emerges through a small puncture in the reindeer's back. The pupa drops to the ground and hatches into a new fly. While it lives in the deer, the warble causes weight loss, skin damage, and irritation. It can also spread a serious livestock disease, brucellosis. The treatment program has been funded by the state and Soho Alaska Petroleum Company. Reindeer are rounded up and injected with the drug Warbex, which eliminates the parasite. Warble-free herds are healthier and have lower mortality rates, though they can be reinfected each year by caribou or reindeer-carried flies. Despite such advances, many difficulties still face the reindeer industry. Caribou often travel through grazing reindeer herds, and many join the migrating animals. One of the largest herders on the Seward Peninsula, Nana Regional Corporation, has lost almost half of its 10,000-head herd to caribou over the last few years. Herders would like to keep the animals apart, but to move the reindeer far enough away takes a large amount of good grazing land. A few thousand reindeer require several hundred thousand acres of moss and lichen-covered ground. If overgrazed, lichen can take several decades to recover. Because reindeer and caribou eat the same food, their increasing numbers may bring them into competition for a finite amount of grazing land. Agencies which now permit reindeer to graze across state and federal lands must weigh the best use of our state's resources and balance the industry's needs with those of the rapidly expanding caribou herds. Despite problems, the reindeer industry is working to see that one of the least known but most successful agricultural ventures in Alaska continues.